Welcome all of you to this talk. We're delighted to have Professor Nancy Toms to give a talk today on an intriguing and timely topic, Confessions of a Failed Pandemic Planner. And I will introduce her in a moment, but first I have just a few words to say about some upcoming Zoom events here at the Institute. On February 10th, Wednesday, next Wednesday, a book talk by our colleague Adam Clulo, Amboina 1623, Fear and Conspiracy on the Edge of Empire. The following Monday, February 15th, there will be a panel that the Institute is doing in collaboration with Planet Texas 2050, and we are delighted to have their collaboration. It's very much part of the Institute's theme this year, Climate in Context. It's the Environmental Protection Agency at the half century mark, 1970 to 2020, with a distinguished panel that will be at noon on Monday, February 15th. On Monday, February 22nd at 12, Environmental Justice in Indian Country and Moving Toward a Transformational Land Ethic by Dina Julio Whitaker of California State University in San Marcos. I welcome you all to those and other Institute events. You can sign up, you can register online on the Institute's website. Before we start, I want to thank Courtney Mador, as always, for making everything run smoothly, and Brittany Irwin for her taking on the task of fielding questions when we get to the question part of this event. So our speaker today, Dr. Nancy Toms, is a distinguished professor of history at Stony Brook University and a research affiliate at the Institute for Historical Studies this year. Her research interests have ranged widely over the past four decades, but almost all her work is focused on the intersection between expert knowledge on the one hand and popular understandings on the other of the body and disease. She's the author of several publications, including A Generous Confidence, Thomas Story, Kirkbride, and the Art of Asylum Keeping, Madness in America, Cultural and Medical Perceptions of Mental Illness Before 1914, The Gospel of Germs, Men, Women, and the Microbe in American Life, and Remaking the American Patient, How Madison Avenue and Modern Medicine Turned Patients into Consumers. She has also co-edited two collections, Medicine's Moving Pictures, Medicine, Health, and Bodies in American Film and Television, and Patients as Policy Actors. She has also created a website, Medicine and Madison Avenue, on the history of health-related advertising, developed in collaboration with Duke University Libraries Special Collections. So without further ado, I will hand things over to Dr. Toms.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here today. I want to take this opportunity to thank all the fine Austin folks who have managed to make me feel welcome as a fellow, despite all the COVID obstacles. That includes Megan, Erica, Melissa, Miriam, Pauline, Phil, and Courtney, of course. I also had the pleasure of meeting some of your fine graduate students today, including Brittany. So I know when I finally get to Austin, and I will someday, I'm already going to feel at home. So I'd like to start this talk with the COVID equivalent of a land acknowledgement. You've probably heard these at the beginning of talks, a person starting with an acknowledgement of the native people on whose lands they stand. In my case, that would be the Nisiquag. But in all the talks I've given since the pandemic started, I have wanted to acknowledge all the many ways that my privilege as a white woman of means has protected me from the worst of this pandemic. I live in a nice house. I have my salary e-deposited every 2 weeks, and I can Zoom around the country. And to make use of that privilege, I've been thinking a lot over the past almost now a year about how to use what I know to promote the kind of deep change we so desperately need. And so this talk is one little step in that direction. Now, I realize some of you may be feeling COVID fatigue. I certainly feel that setting in. I don't know if any of you in this session today went to the talk yesterday by Jewel Mullen from your Dell Medical School about health equity in the COVID vaccine. It was really a sobering account of the difficulties of using algorithms to decide who gets the vaccine first. A lot of very complicated and vexed issues that we're facing.
Nancy, I hate to do this, but in time of COVID, this is what we do. Can you speak up just a bit?
Oh, sure. How's that? Is that better?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I'm too far away from the microphone. I'm also trying to read. So if I'm not looking straight at you, you know, it's because I'm looking at my talk. But I hope what I'm going to share with you today will be of interest to you as historians. It's a kind of a hybrid of some critical historicizing, but also personal reflection on the history of pandemic preparedness planning. I am going to reflect sheepishly, sadly, I don't know what the right adverb is, on what went wrong with the US response to COVID-19. And in so doing, I join a vast cottage industry of both journalists and academics who have piled on the question what went wrong with our pandemic response. And historians, I think, have some important contributions to that discussion. At one level, it may seem obvious that what went wrong was the wrong man was in the White House. Much as I agree, that is hugely consequential. The seeds of failure were already planted beforehand for reasons I'm going to suggest today. And I must confess this, as you'll see, is a deeply personal experience of frustration for me, in that I can see how remarkably naive my assumptions were about how you learn from the lessons of history. I've spent the past 6 months reading much more about the worldview of early 21st century pandemic preparedness. And it's reading I wish I'd done before I had so many opinions on the subject. So here is my plan for today. I'm gonna start with an overview of the history of pandemic preparedness in the early 21st century. I'm gonna talk more specifically about the role of historians in looking back at the great influenza epidemic in shaping that plan. And finally, I'm going to offer some initial reflections on what went wrong. And let me just start with a quote. I'm not skilled enough that I can run a quick poll, but I'm going to ask you this question, let you read something, ask you this question, and I just want you mentally to come up with a name. Read this quote and just think for a minute, what US president do you think said this? I'll read it so you can contemplate. A pandemic is a lot like a forest fire. If caught early, it might be extinguished with limited damage. If allowed to smolder undetected, it can grow to an inferno that spreads quickly beyond our ability to control it. Who said that? What president said that? Okay, you've got it in your mind now. I've done an informal survey today, and everyone I have asked has either named a Democratic president. I've gotten Franklin Delano Roosevelt and Barack Obama, but I've also gotten Theodore Roosevelt. None of the above is true. If any of you, the name that popped into your head was your own Texan president, George W. Bush, you're right. In fact, the first comprehensive 21st century pandemic preparedness plan was first developed during the Bush administration in its post 9/11 security reckonings. So why is it George W. Bush that initiates this formal pandemic? Let me start with an important caveat, because I know I'm speaking to historians. Let me make very clear that I well know that pandemic preparedness did not start in the early 21st century. Efforts to understand, evade, and prevent pandemics long predate the 21st century. And there's a lot of great work being done on the history of pandemics, and I'd like to give a shout out to Monica Green here, so doing terrific stuff on the medieval period. Until the late 18th century, the dominant Hippocratic understanding of epidemics was that they originated from climactic and astronomical conjunctions that and weather also. And it meant that there was relatively little belief that pandemics could be effectively prevented or managed. You couldn't control the weather by human agency, you could pray. But the best advice well into the 19th century was, if there's a pandemic, run away, get away from it as best you can. Now in the 19th century, that sense of powerlessness began to fade. New scientific understandings of contagion, including the gradual acceptance of the so-called germ theory of disease, that specific microbes cause specific diseases, inspired new efforts to prevent and control the spread of infectious diseases. And from the late 19th century to the early 21st century, efforts to control contagion have been a big part both of public health, but also of national security planning. But I am going to today leap over all that interesting earlier history. I'm glad to answer questions about it in the Q&A, but instead I'm going to focus on a much more recent period of pandemic planning and the role that historical research played in it. So what are the long-term precipitants of this early 21st century concern with biosecurity and biodefense? You'll see on the slide, a summary from Lakoff and Collier's collection on biosecurity from 2008 that gives a good list of what came together to create this sense of urgency. And the environmental piece of this is important, since this year focuses on environment and history, that the kinds of arguments that the global climate change was creating a world that was a warmer and wetter world out of balance. These are from Laurie Garrett's famous bestseller, The Coming Plague, that combined with bioterrorism, new technological capacities to manufacture pathogens.
Nancy, I'm afraid you are frozen. There we go.
Am I back?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell me, had I gotten to 9/11 as the turning point?
No, not yet.
Okay, so you can see the long-term precipitants I just went through. I think those are, am I still there?
Uh-oh. Yes.
Yes. Okay, good. Those are trends you're probably familiar with. The short-term precipitants are what I want to move to next, and that the importance of the individual in historical contingency, is the fact that George W. Bush, who was a history major at Yale, on his summer vacation, read John Barry's The Great Influenza, Barry's account of the World War I pandemic. And that reading convinced him, along with what else he was hearing, that we needed a more beefed up bio defense. As he stated in a 2005 announcement, if we wait for a pandemic to appear, it will be too late to prepare. So really formal planning at a national level of how to respond to a pandemic of influenza was developed during the Bush administration and then carried over into the Obama administration as well. So the bottom line here is that we had a plan in place as of 2016. Okay, so what were the essentials of this national pandemic plan? Now, let me just start by saying you may be wondering, why did they pick influenza rather than coronavirus? In fact, the SARS outbreak of 2002-2003 had really put coronavirus on the pandemic radar, but influenza was still assumed to be the greater threat at this time. In large part due to the World War I pandemic, but also because of the deadly avian flu outbreak in 1997. Also, for planning purposes, flu was not a bad stand-in for any airborne virus. So it was a good proxy for the coronavirus family. And in fact, the COVID-19 essentials are essentially the same as those drawn up in this influenza plan. I'll just note, you see here the essential assumptions of this was the need for the U.S. to pursue global cooperation, especially with the WHO, the need for extensive coordination of federal, state, and local agencies, the key priorities, promoting early detection, stockpiling of vaccines and medical equipment, and public education about pandemic prevention. Now, after what we've been through in the last year, it may come as somewhat of a surprise for you to see that this was in fact a bipartisan plan. Obama accepted it and only embellished it. Why was this bipartisan process of planning so successful? Because it was framed as a national security issue, that this was something that the United States needed a kind of planning, that it needed to keep the nation safe from outside enemies. So there was a kind of pulling together us against them. In this plan, there is, at least so far as I can see, no recognition or interest in the role of climate change in creating these new pandemics, but it was still reflected a lot of public health concerns about what we needed to be ready if a new pandemic started. Now, what may come as the biggest surprise to you is to find out that in fact, historians were involved in the development of pandemic planning. In policy circles, something called a look back has become fashionable. And basically a look back is Rand Corporation talk for looking back at an event in the past that may yield some valuable insights about how to manage a problem in the present. So it was not just STEM fields, it was not just the algorithms for detecting disease that got funding. It was also historical research into the primarily the 1918-1919 pandemic. And here I want to call out the importance of the University of Michigan project led by Howard Markell and his colleagues that really was the star player in this initiative. If you have not yet taken a look at the extraordinary digital encyclopedia and archive that they have set up, I give you the URL there. It's amazing. And again, this is all material that was put together as a result of funding. Started with the idea that we could learn something from the history of the World War I pandemic. I was eventually recruited to be part of that collaboration, very much a bit player, but I'll get to that more in a moment. So probably in the last 6 months, you have heard more about the great influenza than you ever want to hear again. But let me just go over a couple of key points about why it was the logical choice for this historical look back. This particular strain of the H1N1 influenza was impressive in its deadliness. And you can just see these comparative death rates of World War I combat deaths compared to the deaths from the influenza pandemic. That 50 million is a very squishy number. It's gone up steadily in the past 10 years. One thing we have realized is how spotty the number counting was in this time period, and in particular the India. We think of massive death rates that were not counted. The number is sometimes as high as 75 million people trying to guesstimate. And to give you a point of comparison with the more recent global pandemic of HIV/AIDS, the death rate as of 2018 is 32 million. So we are still talking about a pandemic that killed a whole lot of people. And for that reason, as the most recent global pandemic in the past century, it has attracted all of this attention. But a second reason that there was so much attention to the World War I pandemic was its utility as a great natural experiment. And by that, I mean the way that the influenza spread in the 1918-1919 set up a series of laboratories, natural laboratories. And I'm just gonna focus on the US, but this kind of analysis has been and can be done in other countries as well. Watching the way it spread was a good way of tracking how a pandemic would spread if you had no effective treatment. Now you'll notice I do not call it the Spanish flu. That's a nickname, misleading, because the Spanish press reported on deaths from the pandemic because they were not at war. There was more reticence about acknowledging it in the combatants. So I'm going to follow John Barry and just call it the Great Influenza. It started in the fall of 1918. Multiple outbreaks in different parts of the world. It's not clear which was first. If anyone tells you a specific location, my understanding is that is still a very unsettled question. We do know that the spread was first noticeable among troops who were actively involved in World War I. And then as those troops were moved about and deployed homeward as the war was coming to an end, that the influenza jumped to civilian populations. It was a highly contagious and much more deadly than the usual annual flu. And it had a different pattern of mortality in that it killed more people, young people in their prime of life. And so in public health, they'll talk about the U versus the W. The normal influenza is the U shape for 1911 to 1917. The people most likely to die are either very young or very old, people who are fragile for different reasons. The 1918 death rates, you can see the extraordinary spike of people in the prime of life. So this is another reason it was such a terrifying pandemic. Now, what did they know about influenza that they could combat it in this time period? And again, this is a piece of what makes it such an interesting look back. I'll go through this very quickly, happy to entertain questions later. What did they know about influenza by 1918? The germ theory of disease had ceased to be a theory and was accepted scientific fact in most places. Bacteriology had rapidly advanced in the previous 20 years. But with available microscopes, the traditional microscopes, scientists could only see bacteria. They had, by 1918, done various kinds of very crafty experiments to show that there were infective particles smaller than bacteria. They called them filterable viruses. That's because they used filters to screen them out. But they couldn't actually see a virus until the invention of the electron microscope in the late 1930s. Throughout the pandemic, there was debate among scientists over whether the influenza was caused by a bacteria or a virus. That was not resolved at the time. And it's really takes much later before the viral nature of flu is established. And in the 1990s, it's only then that you really get the incredible scientific tools that were where scientists were able to go and to get specimens of the World War I influenza and to reconstruct its genome. That is a wonderful and creepy story that I don't have time to tell you. So they knew it was infectious. They suspected it might be a virus. They knew without a doubt that it was very contagious and very deadly. The fear inspired by this influenza pandemic was magnified by its early arrival, especially in the cities of Boston and Philadelphia, were hit the first in September and October 1918. Again, you've probably seen a zillion iconic shots of the great influenza. This is one from Boston in this time period. And what, again, made this foreboding especially ominous was that you could see it coming at you. By historic standards, this was a highly mediated pandemic in the sense that it arrived at a point where in the so-called golden age of American newspapers, there were multiple editions in the morning and the afternoon of papers competing for readers. And although initially the war news tended to kind of keep the flu news a little bit out of the limelight, very soon the level of newspaper attention to the pandemic really skyrocketed. So you could be anywhere in the United States that had a newspaper and get some very scary information. This is a headline from Brookline, Massachusetts, outside Boston. So it's in part because of this constellation of historical characteristics that this pandemic made a good candidate as a look back exercise in the efficacy of social distancing measures. The great influenza replicated key features of what a modern pandemic would present, in that it would be a new disease that could spread quickly along existing networks, transportation. There would not be immediately a magic bullet to slow it in its track. As you probably know, it's still true for viral diseases that antivirals are much less effective than antibacterials. And it was assumed in this 21st century planning that it would take a while to develop a vaccine. Yeah. So you needed to rely on what, in, again, this is policy talk, became known as non-pharmaceutical interventions to slow down and minimize a pandemic spread. And in this respect, the great influenza's march across the United States set up a series of these natural experiments where you could see how different towns and cities, different parts of the country, different points in time, varied in what social distancing measures they chose to adopt. And you could by, the statistics are not great, but you could look at their death rates and correlate them with how quickly they adopted a particular social distancing measure. And you could look at what seemed to flatten the curve. This is the phrase that Howard Markel evidently came up with over dinner talking to one of his collaborators. Essentially, the idea was you would buy time until you could get a vaccine by implementing social distancing measures. Okay, let's look at the great influenza and see how did this play out in real time in this historic pandemic. So I show you here the front page of a landmark article that Howard Markel and his collaborators published in JAMA in 2007 that essentially said, let's look at the influenza as a way of understanding the power of social distancing measures and see what we can learn from this experiment. And again, just to underline, there are no antivirals, there are no antibacterials. In 1918-19, we're talking about a disease that the only treatment could be supportive treatment, but your best way to manage it was to avoid its spread, to try to minimize its spread. Now, what kind of evidence came out of this look back, looking at different cities and the timing at which they adopted different measures? First, let me just explain what was the social distancing toolkit that was available in World War I. It's going to sound very familiar to you. In fact, if there's anything that has just been very strange for me over the past year is how much of what we are told to do would have been the same message given to my grandmother in 1910. How did public health authorities try to manage a pandemic in that early 20th century? Well, your best bet was to rapidly identify sick people and isolate them from well people to break the chain of infection. Hopefully you would put them in a hospital where they would get supportive care. You didn't want to just put them on an ice floe and push them away. You wanted to get them into a hospital, contain them there, and that would help them survive, but also break the chain of infection. Now, just in case, and you could bet with a highly contagious flu strain that you weren't going to find everybody. People would be walking around sick pro domo before they knew they could give it to other people. You needed to be able to limit face-to-face contact among everyone else. So you wanted to think about how to limit face-to-face contact. Hence school closures, business closures, and limits on public gathering were all strategies that were used during the great influenza. And last but not least, the last line of defense was you as an individual should practice very careful personal hygiene, hand washing, protecting others from your coughs and sneezes and spitting, and in some parts of the United States for the general public, mask wearing. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. So here's where I came into the historical picture, in that as historians are trying to drill down on what Americans understood about these social distancing measures, they took as a point of departure the book that I published in 1998. In other words, what I did in that book was look at how the germ theory of disease was sold to average Americans starting in the 1880s up through World War I. My focus in this book was not on epidemic diseases alone, but on all infectious diseases, including ones that were around all the time, like tuberculosis. But what I wanted to understand is how people changed the way they behaved to stop getting sick from infectious diseases. How did the knowledge of how germs moved around in the world changed the way you kept your home, ate your food, and how you behaved in terms of your personal hygiene. And what I discovered, and here, confession time, when I went back to look at the Gospel of Germs, in fact, I think I spent less than a page on the World War I influenza pandemic. One of my friends said, you know, not to worry, that really wasn't what you were doing here, but I still feel a little weird about that. Luckily, the University of Michigan folks gave me a chance, a do-over, so to speak, where I went back and looked at what happened to this Gospel of Germs during the pandemic. And what I discovered immediately was the importance of the tuberculosis, anti-tuberculosis movement, which had become a real pioneer of health education methods in this time period. And although tuberculosis and influenza are very dissimilar in their basic makeup, the role of droplet infections, of coughing, sneezing, and spitting is similar. And that's why the TB protocols were adopted for influenza control as well. As of 1918, the assumption was that the same basic mechanisms of transmission worked for flu as they did for a TB, and thus if you you broadened the TB education, you could slow down the spread of influenza. Now, this, I'm not gonna spend a lot of time, but it's just to give you a little more understanding of what the pathways of contagion were believed to be in 1918. And you'll see, out to the side, I use this slide in my class. I try to talk about whether or not these pathways are still accepted in public health practice. Person to person was by far the most important, sneezing, spitting, coughing. Also dust and dirt that germs could dry up and then the dust could infect someone. That's complicated how much that still applies today. They were terrified of flies. They were worried about fomites, objects that could carry, handled by a sick person. This is something that, I'll be honest, has really surprised me how much of this has come back. When I used to teach this, I would talk about the fear of library books and go, ha, ha, ha. Now I return my library books and they're in quarantine for 3 days. So anyway, don't laugh. But this was, the basic pathway for understanding how germs move from the sick to the well. So I ended up writing this article. It appeared as part of a special issue of Public Health Reports of historians sort of filling out the story of the great influenza. And what I was asked to do was to look more at the public health messaging during the pandemic, and specifically about the need for social distancing. And what I wrote was this article 2010 on what in fact turned out to be the difficulties of managing the masses, and that the masses was a word that was coming into common use by the 19 teens and 20s, especially in big cities. And what struck me when I went back to look at the debate over social distancing and instituting it, especially big cities, was first the fact that the failure to have any kind of scientific consensus on what so-called germ X, the actual microbe causing the influenza, was not there. It did not stop the belief that this was in fact an infectious disease. And I was impressed with the speed with which the social distancing measures did get out there. And I'm going to show you some of the popular health education devices from this time period. I know they look very primitive by our standards, but let me tell you, by 1918 standards, they were pretty cutting edge. The use of broadsides in public transportation. The image on the left appeared in trolley cars in Cincinnati, Ohio. I thought of this exact slide the last time I went into New York in March and rode on the subway. The 21st century iteration of this was rolling across those little ad screens in the New York City subway. On the right is a kind of broadside very commonly produced by public health departments, often replicated in newspapers, or in this case, also hung in theaters. And there was an effort to try to keep theaters open. And part of the bargain here was, well, if you show some anti-influenza, if you do some public education, you can continue to have theaters open. Early use of visual images, of drawings and rough cartoons. A lot of these, again, if you know the anti-TB visuals, are basically they're repurposed anti-TB posters that have been updated to include influenza. The one on the right, the military theme, was very common in the public health education, that adopting social distancing was portrayed as a public virtue. It was part of being patriotic in this time period. I'll just say one of my most surprising revelations about these images is that I never found an image of a woman. I do not know why, and in Q&A, I could talk about some of my theories. What I found was a great deal of resistance to social distancing measures from businesses that didn't want to close, workers who couldn't afford to stay home, and parents who had no one to watch their kids if schools closed. And the arguments for limiting such disruptions centered on the need to minimize economic disruptions, especially in wartime, and the need to keep up morale. People will get depressed if they can't go to the movies. Sounds familiar. And that was the main point of this 2010, my 2010 reflection, that at the time there was a keen sense that despite everyone's awareness that this was a deadly disease, managing a public health crisis in the networked world of 1918 city was very difficult indeed. I'm sorry, here's some more. I'll skip over these quickly because I'm running out of time. Here's some of the resistance and some of the reasons for why it was hard to social distance. Perhaps the most important lesson, this is from Literary Digest in 1919. Perhaps the most important lesson taught by the pandemic consisted of the realization, I'm sorry, this is me talking in 2010, consisted of the realization that those measures that work the best to control a highly infectious disease, public gathering bans, school closures, and strict quarantine and isolation, were precisely the ones most difficult to implement in a mass society. As an article in the Literary Digest summed it up, influenza spread was, quote, simple to understand, but difficult to control. Oh, here it is. Sorry, I'm getting behind. And in the paper, I tried to articulate the sense of failure that public health leaders felt that they couldn't do better. They felt defeated, not just by the scientific obstacles, but also by human obstacles, the inability to get people to do what was needed. And were I to rewrite that 2010 article, I would add much more emphasis on the same points I made in the Gospel of Germs, that living and working conditions sharply differentiated the ability of Americans to social distance. And if people did not have running water or sewers, or were living in homes with 10 and 12 other people to a room, it was impossible to live an influenza-free life. If you can't eat, if you can't work, you can't eat, and you're existing in poorly ventilated spaces, you're going to get sick more likely. So what useful conclusions can be drawn about how to do history during and after a pandemic? I want to be very tentative in my closing remarks. I am not a very good fortune teller, but I do feel confident in predicting on what I know about the old Gospel of Germs, in predicting some things about what it's going to be like when the pandemic is over. I think many features of what are now called everyday quarantine, from mask use to redesign of workplaces and spaces, are likely to remain in place for many years. I think the major economic changes that were underway before the pandemic, but the pandemic has supercharged them, are going to escalate, and that's going to be replacing humans with technology, toll booth workers never getting their jobs back, and that we're going to see a lot of bubble use of technologies, very wealthy people using technology to insulate themselves from future pandemics. Other side effects that we can see, some we can't, are likely to be very negative. I point here to the setback for working moms' gains of the last 20 years. The New York Times had a whole essay on that that was really heartbreaking. All of the above is going to add extreme stress to a healthcare system that was under extreme duress before the pandemic, massive burnout among healthcare workers. And could we have done better? Absolutely. That's the last set of ideas I'd like to throw out to you here is, what can we learn about the limitations of the way they went about pandemic planning in the early 21st century? And these are just some very basic ideas that they're not from me, they're from, again, many thoughtful scholars who have been trying to understand what this has come out of this disaster. Certainly a planning that insufficiently acknowledged existing structural inequalities, race-based, but also income-based, assuming a functioning healthcare system when ours was already dysfunctional before the pandemic, assumption of a stable public health infrastructure when in fact public health funding never regained where it was before 2008, and planning that assumed that advances in science and technology are value neutral and thus are going to be accepted as value neutral by everyone hearing them. And again, for those of you who do the history of medicine and science, you're amazed, but in fact, that is a very common assumption, is that if you just do the science right, you should come out with the right measures. From what I can see, the approach really doubled down on investments in surveillance, of monitoring and vaccine development, trying to keep sick people out of the United States, never a real planning for what would happen if the pandemic started to spread quickly in the United States. And in hindsight, the many ways that this plan could go wrong have become painfully evident. And again, I'm very aware of how complicated both scientific reasoning and viruses are. It's easy to be an armchair critic with a fast-moving airborne virus that really moves much quicker than our ability to adapt. This kind of planning also does not, it assumes a level of cooperation and deference. It doesn't allow for ideology that a different president with no interest in science would decide to ignore all of this planning or to try to use the pandemic to get back at his enemies in the blue states. And I become particularly interested in looking at the science communication piece. And since I'm really running out of time, I'll just say that's one area I want to go more into as I think more about COVID and the problems it's shown in our deficit model of science communication, that all you have to do is provide people with the right information and they will immediately believe everything that that you have to tell them. Clearly not the case, and one area we need to get more realistic is in that area of science communication. So I'm going to stop there and eagerly, I know I've kind of gone over my time, gotten excited here, but I'm very interested in hearing your suggestions and questions. And just so you know, I am booked to give a second talk to the Health Humanities Research Group on April 5th. That will be more about the communications piece. Oh, thank you. I need this.
All right. So our Q&A section can begin now. As a reminder to the viewing audience, the Q&A function lets you type out your question. If you have a quick question that you'd like to say yourself, you can use the raise hand function, but we are short on time today, so we'll do the best we can. I'm going to read out the Q&A questions so that you can hear them, Dr. Tom, and then we can go from there. So first question is from faculty member Abina Oseo-Asari.
Yes, says, yes, hi, Abina.
Yes, she thanks you for your talk. She says, this is making me sad we cannot link up in person in Austin, but then we wouldn't be having this amazing talk either. It is really interesting to learn about the role of historians in impacting the flatten the curve narrative. I am curious, though, what you think the shortcomings of linking the flu to COVID-19 have been. Mm-hmm. I am thinking of a robust conversation that historian of medicine Stephen Casper started over Twitter. Mm-hmm. His point is that since Americans have lived with flu and are not afraid of it, this made people not nervous about COVID-19.
I think that's that is precisely the kind of problem at the ground level that policy planning doesn't account for. You know, in policy planning, the flu was very scary in 1918, 1919. So we should focus on flu as our model for social distancing. It doesn't really take into account that explaining the difference between the annual influenza and pandemic influenza, that whole conversation hasn't taken place, which I think is a point that Steve was trying to make in that Twitter thread. On the whole, I think we do a very poor job of distinguishing among diseases. It's just like they're all alike at some level, and part of what pandemic the 21st century model is to scare everyone. And there's a certain amount of fatigue that comes along with that, that I think is also a complicating factor. It's not just influenza, but Ebola, Zika, you know, there's this long list of things that were supposed to be a threat that didn't materialize, at least in the United States. So yes, good observation.
All right, thank you. Let's see, the next question comes from George E. Sylvie, who asked, what role did news media play, if any, during the height of the so-called Spanish flu?
So a good question, and the role of the news media also touches on the role of partisan politics, because of course the golden age of newspapers were usually affiliated with political parties as well. And so they're kind of an interesting place to look for the extent to which responses to the flu became part of party politics. Flu news sold papers. So there was a real incentive for the papers to cover flu stories. In my reading, that one thing I have to tell, to emphasize with the comparison, kind of to go back to Abina's question, is the Spanish, the great influenza was very short. We're talking about 6 to 8 weeks. It's not a whole year of news coverage. So most of what you get is still reporting on what's happening in a pretty neutral recounting of what the public health department is doing about it. You don't get a lot of dirty laundry being hung out in the dailies. Where you do see that kind of dirty laundry getting discussed is in the public health literature, the state public health journal. A lot of fighting between local and state public health. But overall, the media coverage, I don't want to call it neutral because it's always framed by the war, that this is a patriotic issue, that we need to be worried about the pandemic. But there's not the kind of investigative reporting. You know, Washington Post is going to show you what didn't happen there. So, whoops. Oh. Sorry, I just hit the keyboard. Are you still there? Yeah.
Yes.
So it was intense coverage, but not as into the weeds with all the problems. You do see it in letters to the editors and editorials, some kind of sniping. Why aren't things going better? But it's a very small part. A lot of it is just kind of, here's what's happening on the front lines.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Okay. We have a question from Melissa Cherenko, who is an IHS fellow.
Hi, Melissa. I know Melissa.
who asks, can you speculate about why women were not depicted in the public health campaign broadsides?
Yes. So I've been asked this question a lot because a lot of journalists read that 2010. It kind of took on a life of its own. And that was a question I got. I really had to go back and think about whether I still believed in the answers I gave in the article. And I do, basically. And it moves on two fronts. The first is that there was an assumption that being careful about your personal hygiene was easier for women than it was for men, that it was the boys who were really going to be the problem. That, you know, the macho man didn't want to cover his nose when he was sneezing or use a hanky. So they were being targeted because they were perceived as 90% of the problem. There are still differences that show up in things like hand washing, that women are more likely to do things like washing their hands. Why that is, I think it has a lot to do with the woman's perceived role as a health educator in the family. So that's the kind of I think, the main reason. A subterranean reason that someone suggested to me is that Talking about sneezing and showing women sneezing was considered indelicate. And there is a kind of, go figure, there's a sort of erotic underground of equating sneezing with orgasms. I kid you not, I'm not making this up. So that showing women sneezing could really be, you know, kind of set off a lot of concerns about indelicacy. I'd like to go and investigate that more, but those are kind of the two big reasons that I came up with.
All right, thank you. Let's see. We had a question come in from Chip Clark, who says the following.
Hi, Chip. Yes.
Given the foolishness that elites show when they do plan for disaster, why do you seem so trustworthy of them going forward?
I'm not. This is my friend Lee Clark, who is a world authority on disaster planning and its vicissitudes. If I gave you that impression, in fact, this whole talk is kind of mea culpa for myself getting taken in, of thinking that I was so excited as a historian that they were listening to me. In fact, they weren't listening to me at all. So I do not have a lot of faith in elite planning. And whatever planning, however we're gonna get to a better place, I think it's gotta be radically different, but you know as well as I, what does that look like? So that is a conversation you and I, we will have, because I don't know how to go forward, except this pandemic, the more I read about it, the more it's like, what a nightmare. It's based on so many false assumptions.
Okay, next question. Question from Christopher Sellers. In two parts. Okay, part one, was there little or no analysis of the racial and economically unequal impact of the 1918 flu during the historians' discussion, including what they saw as implications for similar events today? Yeah. And part two is, has that neglect also characterized recent pre-COVID public health more generally? Do you think the huge disparities in COVID impact are more due to public health blind spots or to diminishing public health capacity?
To answer the second question, I'd see more diminishing capacity because in fact, there's a lot of awareness. Pandemic planners, I mean, there are public health people in pandemic planning, but a lot of them are not in public health. So I think the public health has been more aware of these. But the question, I'm glad you raised that about racial and ethnic disparities. In fact, that was a major focus of the Michigan reexamination. And if you go and look at that that public health reports, there's a piece in there by Alan Kraut on immigrants, and there's a piece in there by Vanessa Gamble on race. And much to their surprise and our surprise, the great influenza was not constructed as a disease where either people of color, immigrants, or recent immigrants were seen as the focal point for infection. Now you may say, how could that? They certainly were in every other infectious disease of this time period, but not the pandemic flu. And again, I haven't gone back and read their articles in a while, but the wartime thing is really important here because the natural experiment, it was clear that the focal point for the start of the pandemic were the troops, returning troops. And those were largely white men. There were some black men in the military, usually in behind the lines, but there was no way you could conceptualize where it was coming from, except it's the doughboys coming home. So this kind of cut off the knee jerk, it must be those irresponsible others causing the problems. So again, it kind of goes back to the point that Abina and Steve made about not using influenza, the pandemic influenza in some ways does not work as well because the wartime stuff really kind of throws off the comparisons.
Okay, I'm afraid we're going to have to close up, but I want to thank you very much for this fascinating talk, which, you know, resonates with us with special force.
Yes.
And it was a chance to use history to understand things that do repeat themselves as well as things that don't. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.